Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
We have a great speaker today. I'm so glad you guys were able to come out and see him. His name is Tom Doctoroff. He works for JWT. He runs their China operations. He's been in China and Hong Kong for the past umpteen years and just has done incredible research and incredible thinking on how to market to the new Chinese consumer. It's something that we talk about a lot and something that we have a lot of conjectures about, but this is something that is actually his job, and he has a lot of trial and error behind what he has to say, and I'm just very, very pleased that he and JWT could be here today to share with us their amazing work in this area. So I do hope that you enjoy it. And please help me welcome Tom Doctoroff.
Thank you very much. I have to admit from the very beginning that unlike you guys, I exist at the very fringes of business legitimacy. So I apologize beforehand. But you know, this is actually about advertising, positioning. Can I just take a quick survey? How many people work in marketing or anything having to do with marketing? Okay. Now, if I were to ask anybody, okay, their point of view on like what the biggest business challenge is in China, what would you say? Somebody want to venture a guess in terms of what's a big problem in China these days? Piracy, from your point of view. Okay, that's a big one. Yeah.
Censorship.
Uncertain political structure. I heard political corruption. Well, I guess those are all big problems. My view of what the biggest issue in China is all those are important, but I think that overcapacity is the big problem. I mean, what you basically have in China is a state-owned economy, which is still huge. It's a command economy. And as a result, you have this incredible overcapacity of goods flooding the countryside, and every province has a different television set. So what happens when you have overcapacity? You have declining prices. What happens when you have declining prices? You have declining profits. When you have declining profits, you have what the government fears most of all is this dreaded social instability. And then revolution could reoccur. So basically what we're going to be talking about here is the ultimate problem, which is commoditization. Commoditization. And what is commoditization? When nobody's willing to pay 1 cent more for a product. And although I am not in high tech, I'm not Mr. High Tech, I can tell you that Microsoft's biggest problem in China is commoditization. You're huge there, but nobody will pay for you. And then the question that we're going to be asking today is, how do you avoid this vicious circle, this cycle of red ink, which just pulls down companies in China, just shoots them out of the sky like pigeons and Dick Cheney? You know? How do you avoid that fate? And Chinese, as we'll see, do believe in fate. And the answer is, in our view, is insight. Insight. Now, advertising people, they use this word insight all the time. Who here speaks Chinese? Sorry? Okay. Insight. Dongcha. Guke dongcha. Consumer insight is really a fundamental motivation for behavior and preference. It answers the question, why? And the best insights, the most motivating insights, the ones that marketers can hitch a star onto, is conflict in the heart. And what we're going to be talking today is, with respect to the Chinese middle class, is the conflict, the struggle, the duality inside every new Chinese heart. That isn't just a result of new income and new choices, but is also a factor in of 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 years of unbroken history. So I'm going to apologize, because this is going to seem very broad at the beginning. I'm going to be taking a little bit of a tour through Chinese culture. Then I'm going to be slowly narrowing it down into what I call the master insight, the one thing the one thing you need to know about the Chinese consumer. And then what we'll do is we'll start using that master insight in different ways for more specific marketing applications. So I'll get to diamonds, I'll get to cars, I'll get to braking suspension systems. Just give me a chance to get through some of this touchy-feely stuff first. I don't want to get into a lot of numbers, but let's just say that there are a lot of middle-class people right now. Now, the definition that we use for middle-class people are households that can, that have about 5,000 renminbi, that's about $600 and something per year, per month, income per month. All right, so really you're talking about $8,000 per year, give or take, is as good a bet as any on what middle-class actually is. And there are about 100 million middle-class people in China now, maybe 110 million, and people project that by the year 2000, there will be about 200 million. And if we take a PPP basis, a purchase power parity basis, China's about 2.5 to 1. So really, it's not a cash-strapped society like we used to think it is. It's still penny-pinched, but still the middle class is growing, and it's a real force. So it's about 100, 110 million people. But I don't really want to talk about this. Now, I'm going to play right now some very superficial videos. We're going to have a lot of videos today about this new Chinese middle class. And the first thing that you're going to notice here is that this could have been shot anywhere in the world except for one difference, and that is it has Chinese faces in it. The new Chinese middle class, just like America? Question mark. Can we get the volume up a little bit, please? Say whenever you have a cat food market, then you know you have a middle class. Now, again, like I just said, this really makes it seem like there's no real difference between the middle class of China and the middle class of France, Britain, America, whatnot. But in reality, make no mistake, the longer that I am in China, and I've been there for 12 years right now, 8 of them on the mainland, the more that I realize that Chinese people and their worldview is fundamentally different from the Western worldview. And what I'm going to do a little bit ambitiously, perhaps even assumptively, with chutzpah, as we Jewish people say, and by the way, Chinese like Jews a lot. I always say there's nothing on earth to fear in Chinese except for a Jew who can negotiate in Chinese, right? But in any case, is a continuing influence of two distinctive legacies. And let me go through them very quickly right now. They sort of define the contours of the Chinese cultural blueprint and the topography of the Chinese commercial terrain. The first one is Confucianism, pop quiz. And we've got a lot of Chinese people here, all right? Can anybody here define what Confucianism is? Anybody want to give me a crack? I mean, it's no Confucianism. That's after Confucius. It's a good start. All right. Anybody want to say what it might be? Because it's everywhere, although most people can't define it anymore. Because during the Cultural Revolution, it was bad. Yes?
Being mild.
Being mild. Pretend to be mild. Okay, that's very insightful.
Loyal to your family, to your
Loyal to your family and your government, yes?
My same age practice
are the opposite of self-centered and respect for elders or... Okay, this gets into filial piety. Okay, well, yeah, I think that's actually pretty good. Confucianism actually has two sides to it. The one that you guys are all talking about is what I call the regimented side. I don't know if we've heard of the wulun, the five key relationships that Confucius identified that dictate the entire structure of society. And by the way, Confucius, he lived in the later Zhou period when China was sort of at war with itself. It was a period of civil war around 500 BC. And what he went around doing is selling this ideal social model which could help preserve the stability of the government and of the whole political structure. So Confucianism is this five key relationships. Those five key relationships are between father to son, between husband to wife, between friend to friend, older brother to younger brother, and also between ruler to ruled. And what these five relationships did is it made responsibilities and roles crystal clear. If you were at a certain point in the hierarchy, you knew what your place in society is. You had no choice as to how you behaved in relationship to other people within that society. So Confucianism is very hierarchical. It's very regimented. There are lots of rules and there are structures. So on one hand, Confucianism is very much like this. It's constricted. But on the other hand, and this is what a lot of people don't think of when they think of Confucianism, is it was the world's first socially mobile system. By internalizing Confucian values, by understanding the Confucian canon, becoming a master in Confucian thought, and later a little bit of Taoist thought, the Si Shu Wu Jing, you could actually take the civil servant exam and you could progress. You could move up a rigid, narrow hierarchy to the top. You could pull yourself up, and not just pull yourself up, but pull your brothers and sisters up, pull your parents up, your extended family up, and then on into the next generation. So Confucianism is really quite a contrast, and this starts getting at the foreshadowing of our master conflict. On one hand, it's a conflict between regimentation and ambition. Ambition. And when you take a look at what's happening in China today and why that's not happening, say, in Thailand to the same extent or even in Japan, that incredible desire to move forward, to move up, to grab the brass ring, that's the dynamic side of Confucian thought. And Confucianism, make no mistake, is alive and well in China. So the first thing I just want to plant in your brains is this conflict between ambition and regimentation. I won't go into this. The next thing is, again, because advertising is an illegitimate profession, so we have to make up polysyllabic expressions, I'm going to phrase the next thing cyclical dynasticism. And the things that I just want you to remember, two words from this next couple of charts. One is fate, and the other is cycles. Fate and cycles. History moving in cycles through a mandate of heaven following an immutable natural order, the limited role of individual in affecting society, civil society is undeveloped, no institutionalized protection of the individual. What do I mean? Well, forget this too. These are pretty pictures. Anybody recognize this? Bagua. Okay, what's the bagua? Somebody can explain it? Used for feng shui. What's feng shui?
It's something about fit.
Something about fit, okay. Sir? What's this? What's this? Okay, it's also the logo that they have on Lost, but we don't know exactly what it means, all right? And by the way, Chinese are addicted to Lost. They download that from God knows how many different sites, all right? But the yin and the yang, the bangua are four masculine elements, four feminine elements that go around in an immutable absolute cycle. There are, again, four masculine, four feminine, and they can be arranged in only 64 different possible combinations. Now, I don't want to get into a mathematical lather here, but the Bagua is the basis of something called the Book of Changes, which was written at the same time as Confucius wrote his stuff, and it's, or in Chinese, the I Ching. And this Book of Changes was used to explain cosmologically, okay, the structure of everything from the heaven and from the stars in the heaven to the sand on the ground. So basically, explaining everything. every spoke and every chain in that great wheel that went around and around and around. So the Bagua is really about cosmological structure, and it's by understanding that cosmological structure that we understand the present, that we understand the past, and that we understand the future. And a lot of the fortune-telling and the omens are based on the Bagua. Now, does anybody recognize this? The Chinese zodiac, okay, so these are technically called the 12 earthly branches. Now, I am a rabbit, so that means that I was born in 1975. Yes, I was born in 1970. Okay, I wasn't born in 75, but I am a rabbit, all right? So what does that make me? One, two. But basically, again, this is a point that time also moves in a cycle for China. What goes around comes around. That which happened is bound to reoccur at every twist of the cycle. And so, again, I don't want you to, you know, get too obsessed about math, but there's also the 10 heavenly stems, okay? And if you combine the 12 different branches and the 10 heavenly stems, what happens? Your fate pops out. Chinese believe in fate. Chinese believe that we are marching, each one of us, towards an ineluctable destiny. Now, that does not mean that Chinese are fatalistic in the sense that they are passive, because Chinese believe that while you cannot change your fate, you can manage it. And what that means is if it's bound to rain, it's going to rain. But a smart Chinese knows when to carry an umbrella. And that is the fate and cycle. So let's just keep these in mind. Right? So how the human history works, of course, is the mandate of heaven, which has to be in harmony with the Bagua and the entire structure of the universe. And when the mandate of heaven runs its course and we're about to enter a new cycle, we know what happens. I mean, there was a big earthquake that happened before Mao left power, and every dynasty has supposedly been presaged or fought by disaster. And this mandate of heaven, right, obviously downplays the individual, which is why no matter what you're talking about in Chinese history in terms of its artistic expression, you know, porcelain, you know, land paintings, calligraphy strokes, music, it's all designed to create a bridge between the individual, the lowly individual here on earth, and the spectacular infinite glory of heaven. The individual does not count. The individual has never been the focus of any artistic expression. So, again, I want to say, if any of this starts feeling a little bit, how do I put this? In a way that I prefer Western civilization, I don't mean that at all. Okay, and I'm not saying that either is superior. Both have strengths and both have weaknesses. And the goal of the 21st century is to somehow form a harmony of opposites between two spectacularly different cultural orientations, but both spectacular. But the individual has never counted for a lot. And when I define individual and individualism, let me make that very clear. Egos are huge in China. Egos. Ambition, as I just said, is huge. But ego is not individualism. Individualism is the encouragement of society to define oneself independent of society. Individualism is Bill Gates in its purest form. And Bill Gates is next to God in China. Bill Gates, not just he became loaded and successful, but he had the courage at a young age to define himself independent of society, to walk outside of Harvard and say, Mom, Dad, society, this is what you think, but I'm taking a different path, and to be applauded for that. So this idea of individualism has never really been strong in China. In fact, individualism is heretical. Now let's compare this just a little bit with Western tradition, Judeo-Christian roots. Anybody recognize this guy back into as Moses, all right? Moses, what did he have? The Ten Commandments. They came from God. Moses and all of the Jewish forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all of them, they had one-on-one relationships, interactive relationships with not a God, but the God, the omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent God. And it was a covenant. By accepting God's absolute morality into the heart, the individual could be empowered. he could be empowered to change his own fate and to change the fate sometimes of mankind in general. The Jews had a collective fate by trying to create Israel, heaven on earth. When you got to Jesus, it became much more personalized by the Sermon on the Mount. But the fact of the matter is that the tradition of Western society is based on a monotheistic humanism, which has never really existed, you know, in China. But this empowering fate made the individual not just valued. I don't want to talk about morals here. It made him productive. Western society is based on an assumption, and so is modern capitalism, that the individual is the basic productive unit of society. In China, that individualism is heretical. So we have, unlike the Chinese, a linear view of historical progress. We believe that we are moving bumpily yet steadily to some higher order promised land. And when George Bush, and I don't want to say whether I'm a Democrat or a Republican, but I have a feeling that this is blue straight, so I'm a Democrat. I really am a Democrat, and you only have to be in China to become sort of like deep, 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 dark blue. But, you know, when George Bush, he marches into Iraq without understanding that, you know, there's going into a different social context, it's because we have an absolutist view of morality. And we also think that American destiny is the world's destiny, and we represent, as Ronald Reagan put it, a shining city on a hill, the destination of all mankind. So all humanity inevitably is marching, according to many classical American thinking, towards a higher promised land, a bumpy yet steady progression to something higher. But it is linear. It's like the stock market. And we believe that the individual, historically with God's help, is able to affect society, and as a result, civil society has been developed. And Chinese, by the way, and if you go to China, there are lots of billboards right now about civil society. Jianju, Wanming Shihui, okay, constructing a civil society. And what I mean by this is, you know, a society based on institutions. Institutions designed to protect not just the human rights of the individual, but the economic interests and productivity of the individual. And that's what capitalism is, of course. It's banks, it's wide extension of credit, it's depersonalized or impersonalized management of financial institutions. So we are institutionalizing, you know, our civil rights so that they are protected, and we as a result have a fairly benign view of the outside world. And it's only when 9/11 happens, or like I say today earlier, McCarthyism, where we're shaken from our fat and happy complacency and say, oh, wait a second, maybe it's not all safe out there. But we believe that we count. We believe that as individuals we matter and we are important. Each one of us has a sense of self, or should. But back to China. Confucian ambition, Confucian regimentation, no institutionalized protection of the individual. And what this all boils down to, and this is a word that's going to be reoccurring and reoccurring throughout this presentation, is insecurity. And when I say insecurity, I do not mean fear. Insecurity is like anxiety. It's like a pebble in your shoe. You walk forward, but you something's bothering you the whole way, right? But you can still move forward. You can even run. Right? Fear immobilizes. Right? Chinese are the last thing from fearful. So, but insecurity. And it has always been insecure because nothing has ever been institutionalized. Leadership in China has always been based on personal leadership endowment. And empower was based on association with the emperor. You're out of the emperor's favor, you're banished and exiled, you, of course, are insecure. The Chinese have an expression, it's like being near a tiger to be near the emperor, which is the Chinese version of he who lives by the sword dies by the sword. Now, the key emperors, okay, were always known not for their benevolence, but for their effectiveness, for their efficiency. And the judgment of whether somebody is a good emperor or a bad emperor is not based on any Western concept of moral human rights. The Chinese have a very pragmatic worldview. Anybody recognize this person? Yeah, the Xiu Huangdi. Anybody see that movie Hero by Zhang Yimou? Okay, so that's about this guy. Jet Li was the hero because he prevented his assassination. But this first emperor was the one that unified China 2,000 years ago for the first time. And he did more than just unify China geopolitically. He standardized weights and measured. He standardized characters. You know, he built a lot of roads. Now, this guy was not a nice guy, all right? This guy killed millions of people. This guy burned scholars alive. He buried people alive. You know, so he wasn't exactly Mr. Warm and Fuzzy, you know, but the Chinese still, if you ask Chinese, do you like him or is he a good emperor or not, 98.4%. I'm making that statistic up, but I'm here with quantitative folk, all right? 98.4% say he was a good emperor. Why? Because he created order from chaos. Mao is the same thing. Every Chinese person knows that Mao made lots of mistakes, as we'll talk later during the Great Leap Forward in the Cultural Revolution. But if you ask Chinese, was Mao good or not, it's not just due to government propaganda. They feel it in their hearts because Mao also created order from chaos. And in China, stability is sublime. The only absolute good in China is order, balance, harmony. The only absolute evil is instability and chaos. So this last one, I'm sure we all saw the last emperor, Bernardo Bertolucci's last emperor. Well, that's the emperor Cixi, empress, the last de facto emperor. She was de facto emperor. And she was a harsh woman. She was a bitter pill to swallow. But Chinese hate her, not because she was bitter, but because she created chaos from order. It was under her reign where the entire, you know, China got carved up in a series of unequal pacts and all the foreigners were let in. So she's not good, all right? Now, this capriciousness has always been there throughout China. Shangyang, Chu Yuan, Sima Qian, Yue Fei, Lin Zishu, and Peng Dehuai. Peng Dehuai was Mao's comrade in arms on the Great March. Peng Dehuai was really a hero, right? But then in 1962, he became a bad guy because he had the audacity to criticize Mao for the Great Leap Forward. The Great Leap Forward, Da Yue Jing, which is probably the most colossal misallocation of resources in human history. 30 million people probably died as Mao tried to preserve his political base or reinforce his political base by industrializing the countryside. So this guy went from being a hero, a legend, an immortal, to being nobody because he crossed Mao by criticizing an economic policy. Liu Shaoqi, again, Mao's number two in the Cultural Revolution, banished from power. The Cultural Revolution, we're getting to the present here, almost. The Cultural Revolution was probably China's most insecure time, 10 difficult years, as it's called in China, and everybody has a different theory on why or how the Cultural Revolution could possibly have occurred, how father could be turned against sons, how families could be split apart. My theory is again, based on the fact that Chinese don't like chaos. What Mao did is he attacked the very fiber of Chinese civilization itself. Chinese have always defined themselves not first as a country, but first as a culture, almost on a spiritual level. And what Mao did is he attacked every element of traditional Chinese culture as not just unproductive, but evil. Anything that did not support the absolute worship of the emperor, everything else was bad. Before, nobility was good. Now it's bad. Before, scholarship before was good, now bad. Sloping roofs, the Monkey King, calligraphy, fine arts, all expression of culture that is traditionally Chinese, has been for thousands of years the essence of a country's soul, was banished and considered evil. So what happened is every Chinese person himself was polluted. The genes were infected. So people were at war with themselves. It was profound disorientation, even a way that makes Nazi Germany look a little bit, at least more focused. Chinese were a little bit, and excuse the analogy, like dogs chasing their own tail, because the enemy is me. Where is the enemy? The enemy is me. So again, creating a huge cultural disorientation and huge chaos that this is what started it. But here's just a fun little video before I start getting into commercials. This is Cui Jian, the rock star. 行走过每天多两万五千里，都敢说每天都是日不落地，每天都奋战斗，寻找万字里。 Then he came, Deng Xiaoping, who is taught in the school books now to be addressed as Deng Ye Ye, Grandpa Deng. Now, he was a hero. He was, in my American view, even a hero, because he snatched China from the jaws of hysterical self-destruction. It was he who, in 1992, went down to the southern Guangdong province and said, to get rich is glorious, thereby unloading a flood of investment through the special economic zone, which created what we now, 10 or 12 or 15 years later, have as a very robust middle class. But one thing I want to make right now that quite clear is that when he said to get rich is glorious, right? And he also said, by the way, Rang Yi Bu Fun Xian Fu Qi Lai. He was saying some people are going to get rich first. Okay, so this is not going to be egalitarian. So that's what he means by socialism with Chinese characteristics. But he was not flirting with Jeffersonian enlightenment. He was talking not about your right to get rich, but your obligate to generate capital for the benefit of a strong modern China. The idea of getting rich was first and foremost, according to ideology, to service the greater good of a great China. Now, not getting too economical, too much into economics, but China is much richer right now. And what you have going on in China is really an incredible virtuous cycle, despite all the problems with the banks and the capital markets, of a consumer market with scale, of an economy and an industrial capacity with scale as well, and the emergence of specialized secondary industries, which are all really mutually reinforcing. And the world hasn't seen such an emergence of the Holy Trinity like this since America at the end of the Industrial Revolution. But despite all of this wealth, wealth is still not secure, and nor is the new middle class, for various reasons. The iron rice bowl, the Tiefawan, is already rusted. So there is no sure social security anymore. That's why savings is so high, because people don't think that their wealth is protected. Secondly, high-income individuals are still dependent on the party's continuing endorsement of getting rich. The party still has to mandate or endorse growth policies. They're not yet baked into the bread. So even now with the party congress that's going on right now, there is this huge debate going on between this, whether or not we should really be thinking more of social stability or economic growth, and whether or not there is or is not a conflict between those two objectives. Now, Wang Jiabao, who is a very competent prime minister, he says there is no conflict, but they need to be balanced. Most people are living outside the state establishment. They have little power to ensure the policy's continuation. Now, Jiang Zemin, he had something called the Three Represents, or the Sangha Daibiao, and what he was trying to do is extend the party to incorporate the capitalist set. But it's very cosmetic, despite all the tutoring that's been going on. There's only one person that's in the central committee of the Communist Party, and that is, by the way, the head of Hire, the appliance, and there is no safety net. Only 49%, by the way, of urban residents are covered by health care, and only 19% of rural, according to JWT calculations, it's not us who calculated it, are covered by the health insurance. But the key point here is that individuals, even the wealthy individuals, feel like they are outside of the establishment, that their wealth is not protected. Wealth is insecure. I showed this guy this morning as well during a different presentation, because I think he's instructive. His name is Yang Bing. And Yang Bing was the second wealthiest man in China, according to Forbes, but then he built a special economic zone on the other side of the North Korean border. That was going a little bit too far for the government, because the relationship with North Korea is ambivalent at best. And he was thrown into jail for 18 years, and now he's bankrupt. So just imagine, this took even longer than the guys at Enron. You know, this was a week that this happened in, or 2 months. So going from extremely wealthy and extremely powerful to nothing and in jail, wealth is insecure. And every new person in the middle class feels like his wealth is, to a lesser or greater degree, insecure. So as a result of this economic insecurity, and we're moving towards the master insight right now, Chinese have two basic needs, and I don't mean of the Sharon Stone type. The first one feels small, and I apologize for that, but I'll go to something much bigger and more grand and more glorious in a little bit. But that's a protection need, protecting oneself from the unpredictable, protecting achieved status. And you see that everywhere in China, protection signals, okay, the Great Wall, it's protection, right? Protection is, why was it built? It was a 2,000-mile war to build against invasion from the Mongolians and the Manchus. The Xiongnu are other Altaic-speaking tribes who eventually made it into Korea over 2,000 years of history. The Forbidden City, it's built in harmony with the entire cosmological order with moats and squares and rolls and like it should be to protect. All Chinese walls always had Chinese villages had walls. Now this here is the 10th floor of apartment buildings, and they all have bars on the outside, all right, to protect from I don't know what, Spider-Man gone bad. And then you have this, of course, which is my favorite thing in the wealthier apartment complexes, because the bigger your wealth is, the thicker your gate is inside, you know. So you can have security guarded apartment buildings, but you still have to have a double and triple gate with numerous locks to get in, you know. And this, of course, is the Terracotta Warriors, who we've already talked about, that first emperor in Xi'an. The Terracotta Warriors were to protect this emperor, Shi Huangdi, on his inevitably bumpy journey to the afterworld, because he made lots of enemies. Protection, protection, protection. Now, many people think that Chinese people are collective. I disagree. Collectivism, in its purest form, is when people take comfort in fitting in, a la the Japanese. But the Chinese people don't want to be the same as everybody else. The Chinese people, remember, Confucian ambition, they want to stand up. Here's my first product reference. When we market sanitary napkins in Japan, we say to the woman, shh, be careful, don't worry, nobody's going to notice anything. In China, we say, fear not, nothing's going to come between you and success. It's about lifting up barriers, and you see lots of white horses and lots of women galloping over, you know, benches. You know, so really, what we're talking about here is not wanting to fit in, but needing to fit in as a security measure. Here is protection. Palmistry. Omen, lucky charms, the ICAC, martial arts, always defensive, never offensive, the art of war. Bad men everywhere. And a lot of marketers use protection as a very basic marketing strategy, the thing that they want to communicate. Now, these are very simple, one-dimensional ads. Actually, this isn't so simple. This is John Hancock. Key point here is that you never market insurance as an investment. It's always for protection. And I do believe the insurance market in China is ready to take off like a rocket. But notice the dangerous world. Notice about this commercial is it is very protective, but it also has movement forward. Now, I don't want to make huge generalizations, but Chinese also want to move forward. No matter who the Chinese are, they want to move forward, but move forward safely. Like in Taoism, we, by assuming the shape of that which surrounds you, lulled almost in an amniotic fluid, you can move forward still. So that combination is important. This is a high-tech product. This is, I guess, breaking suspension. It's Bosch. And again, this is all about protecting your family from those critical moments of danger. So it really is about how technology reassures to then make life beautiful.
What do we need to better protect the most important things in our lives? First, Boss brought you ABS, providing you control when braking. Bosch went the essential step further on and introduced ESP to stabilize vehicles in a split second at crucial moments. Bosch, invented for life.
By the way, Bosch has done a really good job in the past couple of years at taking something that was completely technological and commoditized and turning itself into a real brand. I will play this commercial because I think that this is a very rare case in China and very instructive, despite the fact that it has nothing to do with computers. It's about Safeguard Soap. Now, Safeguard Soap is a P&G brand. P&G is by far the most successful, consistent, scaled manufacturer in all of China, and they make money. All right? And P&G has one brand called Safeguard Soap. It has a 25% market share, always has, and it's been based on one key element from the very beginning, and that's germ kill, protecting your child from the invasive enemy of germs, but surrounded with Confucian maternal protection. I hope. Maybe not. Uh-oh, I think we have a little problem. I'm frozen. Not of fear, but technologically. Right? Seriously, anybody can help me back there? It's mine. But, huh? Reboot the whole thing? All right, something there. I hope this doesn't keep on happening or I'll be very sad. Here's eBay. If it does keep on happening, I'm going to take a five-minute break, okay, if it does. eBay is, again, all about youthful exploration, obviously new world. But notice how at the end, Ogilvy and Mather, a very, very bad advertising agency, just kidding, it's all about exploration. But still, at the end of it, there's still protection about warranties. And this is the monetization of the Internet is a big, big problem. And we do have a problem. No.
Internet police, by the way. That's internet police.
So basically that end tagline is infinite joy and excitement, and then you've got lots of talks about karate guys and warranties. All right. Huh? Is this PowerPoint 2000? I don't. I mean, that guy. He hasn't been assassinated yet. Now, the other need. Okay, I hope that this plays. If not, is projection. We've just talked about protection, but projection is much bigger. It's much bolder. It's still insecurity based, but it's about projection of status in society. It's basically like saying, "Don't F with me. I'm marking my territory. I am here on the social hierarchy, or here, and you better believe I'm going there." All right. So this is big and it's bold and it has a very, very different feel. Mr. And this is what projection looks like. This is all about neon. right? And the neon is bright, it's gold, it's very colorful. And unlike the neon in Japan, which goes flush up against the building, this neon is horizontal. It thrusts out into the middle of the street, just as if to say something very important is going on here, despite the fact that it might be a keychain shop. And you get this as well. You know, you get all the architecture in China is projective. All the architecture in China is designed to impress from afar, but if you go inside, the doors are very narrow and thin. The washing and the toilet is usually cheap, and for some reason the bathrooms all smell. But this here is Pudong International Airport. Pudong International Airport is the center of evil. I truly believe so. Pudong International Airport, from abroad, it's thrusting, it's looking skyward, and it really is very impressive. It's French designed, but you go inside and everything is designed cheaply with the lowest possible standards. All the bathrooms are on underground. The escalators go down, but they don't go up. There's one elevator in the entire place. The walking way is so narrow that a passive-aggressive traveler can slow everybody down to him to crawl. It represents, I think, the great humiliation of the great cosmopolitan center of Shanghai. Business cards.
I didn't completely understand your opinion.
It's on page 7 of my book, okay? That's how strongly I feel about Pudong International Airport. It's not good enough. But the exchange of a business card is ritualized, as we know. You have to hand it over like this because this business card says everything about that person in terms of where he stands up in society. You need to treat it with a great deal of respect. This is what projection hopefully looks like.
But it's been no bed of roses.
Big and glorious.
No pleasure cruise.
Larger than life.
I consider it a challenge before the whole human race. And I ain't gonna lose.
In public. Dripping with luxury.
They are the champions, my
confidence. Larger-than-life goal, larger-than-life victory. Chinese nationalism. I am China, China is me. Walking through the four corner of power with confidence, ready to defeat the enemy. There's the white horse. That's what projection feels like. It's different. And common personal names. We all know how Chinese name their kids. You have the family name, then you have the given name. But for men in particular, the common names are usually very bright and bold. Kai, Shu, Jie, Shake, Sun, Cosmos, Wei, Jing, Success, Bright, Courage. And usually you'll have, like in the Cultural Revolution, build great, glorious nation, or things like that, you know, really megalomaniacal that gets to the point of. But this is really parents imprinting their hopes for their kids into the name. Now, women, by the way, never have these names except in very unusual cases. Women are always very calm, tranquil, precious jade, calm lake, you know, lovely flower type of thing. All right, but for the men, you know, it's all like this. Men want control. Apartment addresses and the names of apartment buildings, another projective device. When I was in Hong Kong, the first thing I said, Toto, I'm not in Kansas anymore. I lived in Tycoon Court, despite the fact that this building most definitely was not for tycoons, all right? But here in China, you have in Shanghai, this is Shanghai, Peacock Dynasty, Heavenly Horse, my very favorite, the gathering of all heroes under heaven. Now that's bold. And then you have the new one going up called Simply Rich Gate, all right? This is all projection. And so this idea of whenever you get into masculine, I'm really in trouble, you guys. Is anything moving up there?
Wireless connection is dropping
out of
hospital.
Huh?
The wireless connection is dropping.
Can you stand up and fix it, please?
No, turn your wireless off.
Oh, wireless off?
Yeah, turn your wireless
off. Oh, that's what's happening.
Well, yeah, it keeps dropping out.
Okay, so I know how to turn it off. Hold on. I hope there's no porn on here. This one. Yeah. Now, how do I turn it off? Right click here.
There you go.
You do it for me, please.
Okay.
Please rescue me.
Yeah, disable that.
Oh. Yeah. Okay, he's working with a very bad touchpad.
Oh. My God, I didn't know that I was committing so many sins in the same presentation. I feel absolutely exposed, all right? I'm using 2000 PowerPoint. There's still the talking paperclip.
You're going to have to work this out for you while you're here.
I'm also the PowerPoint product manager.
All right. So should it work now or not?
Well, let's try it.
And let me try.
Yeah.
This one. This is a cigarette ad. Manly stuff here. V for victory.
Or here's a PDP television set. This is a local brand, and it's designed to bring bigness into your living room. Thank you. I think you saved me. Where's my hero? There he is. There. And also you can have big individualistic projection. This is Ford Focus. Projection can be quiet. This is all about a guy who impresses his girl by becoming the Statue of Liberty, but sotto voce. Mobile phones. Now, the key thing here, of course, is the projection is frustrated by low purchase power, because no matter how you slice or dice it, even with PPP, even Shanghai, the glittering coastal capital of Shanghai, is about 8 or 10 times less wealthy than America. You know, so people have to decide very carefully how they're going to spend their money to project their status. And this gets into the first example of how we resolve this conflict. And we're right now at the Master Insight, by the way. This is the VIP card. Now, in the West, of course, we have a VIP card for very few things like airline miles or things that really, you know, the Visa card. But in China, you cannot leave the corner drugstore, the corner restaurant, the corner newspaper stand, the corner, you know, haircut place, you know, the massage parlors, both the good and the bad kind, both the cheap and the expensive kind of the good and bad kind, without coming out with a VIP card. So the guy who gets around town comes up with a stack of VIPs like this thick. He pulls out his wallet and says, oh, I'm a VIP card here. And he says, I'm a very important person. Can I save some money, please? You know, and so this is really the beginning of the resolution. And here we have the master insight and the master conflict, because the middle class is divided. The hearts of every individual is in conflict, because on one hand, you've got big, bold projection of status. And this is ostentatious spending. This is where the luxury brands come in. This is spending on self. It's impulsive. It's conspicuous. Right? It is why Gucci, Mercedes, Audi all already have big franchises, despite the fact that they're all a big glob of glitter compared to one another. But then also you've got a different And that's protection of status. Now, this is a very deferred gratification. This is savings. This is an investment. This is an investment in computers and the child. This is delayed gratification. This is for the next generation, and it has a stability-minded future focus to it. So every Chinese person is pulled between these very different impulses to buy in a projective status sense and to protect in a savings deferred sense. So people have big dreams, but they feel like small potatoes, and they feel relatively unempowered. So what we're going to do right now is we're going to take a few themes that come from this master insight, this pull between projection and protection, and say how specific products can in fact be put into this paradigm to maximize profit. Because what we're talking about is how you can charge a price premium, not be a commodity. And that's what Microsoft does need to do. So the first one is most basic and most important. That's public display, maximizing public display. People need external recognition of status. They want to project a classy image, but they don't have a little money. So the number one buying rule, in China is people are willing to spend much higher price premiums for badge value products, everything from a meal at Pizza Hut to a mobile phone if they are displayed in public. That's why all in-home brands are local brands. The Hires, the televisions, the Changhong, the TCL, the Kankas, you know, the sewing machines, the bedspreads, the glassware. It's all local brands because they are sold at a very cheap price. And a 3% price premium in this framework can be suicide. So you really have to make sure that you're not presenting yourself as a privately consumed item. And this gets even into things such as spas and luxury goods, because a spa should not make you feel good, which is private. A spa should recharge your battery so you're ready for the next presentation. That's why, again, local brands are dominant in the home. Don't want to get into statistics, but mobile phones, they are always leading brands in the primary and secondary cities. They are all multinational brands. Sony Ericsson, Samsung, which is very hot now, though a little bit technologically, a little bit substance-free. Nokia, which is truly a gold standard. And Motorola, which is coming back, yes?
But what about Huawei and some of the local suppliers?
Well, let's talk about that at the end, okay? But these local suppliers, okay, again, it's not that local brands are considered unreliable all the time. It's just that they don't have active preference by the consumers. And I would suggest that Huawei, particularly in its overseas markets, is competing on a basic price-value equation. But when you're starting to talk about, you know, real brand equity is consumer loyalty over time, the willingness to pay a sustained price premium. Ultimately, brand equity equals profit, right? And Huawei is competing on scale and reliability. Diamond rings, De Beers, okay, had a penetration of 8% for engagement rings in 1996. You can see here that it's as high as 80% in some markets. So we have created a new cultural imperative by talking about what a marriage is in Chinese society. And a marriage is all about projection of a meiman, a beautiful and full future. And when you have a big rock, you're presenting the world, right, that this husband, no matter what, is going to be there for me. He will love me no matter what. He will do anything for me to maintain our stable future. Cars is the same thing. Car growth is exploding, despite the fact that the average car costs 140% of a year's income of the market target, versus 30 to 40%. Subways are getting better. Taxis are super cheap for the middle class. I mean, relatively speaking, you can go a long way for a dollar on a taxi in China. But people are still buying the cars because they are ultimate status projectors. Women don't buy cars yet because women's needs are not all about status in the same way that men is. So the implication is that Mercedes and Louis Vuitton and all of the luxury goods, they're going to have a much easier time naturally than Victoria's Secret. Victoria's Secret will never succeed. Victoria's Secret, okay, is a silk underwear with a 300% price premium that only he sees in the dark, okay? It is the only... It's not going to work, okay? Now, I'm not saying that the brand can't work, but you're going to have to lower the price right for the Chinese market. So dramatized public recognition and admiration. So this is a very typical, crude, projective commercial for Dior.
Enough.
Now, this I think is a heroic commercial, okay, because they're trying to take the ultimate private product, which is toilets, you know, a Japanese company. And as you know, if you've ever been in Japan, toilets do everything but the dishes, you know, and but in China, nobody, the last room to get luxurious is going to be the bathroom. Oh, but here's a statistic for you, by the way. You know, the average Shanghainese in Beijing, they spend about, they have 100 square meters. And, you know, when you buy an apartment in China, usually, though it's changing a little bit, there's no floorboards, there's no light bulbs. Everything needs to be bought by the buyer. Right? The average person for 100 square meters pays only $12,000. Now, we can't even decorate, carpet our front hall for $12,000. Now, this is, you know, toilets. And what they're trying to do with toilets is turn it into an admiration piece. And I believe that they've done it fairly successfully.
It's
a masterpiece.
Toto 科技开创完美
Creating perfection, opening perfection. Now this is the first time in advertising that I've ever heard a toilet or anything else in the bathroom be referred to as a masterpiece, all right? Theme two, and this is status has to pay dividends. Status is not a pretty bauble that just hangs there and says, oh, this is nice, what nice taste you have. Status has to move you forward. So this print ad here says, Iga Shangguan Dian, this is for diamonds, Zui Chengzhou Iga Changzhi. So that sparkle makes the man, right? That sparkle moves him forward. The sparkle is a means of advancement. And it's this reason, by the way, where diamonds are pretty popular for Chinese men, relatively speaking. But the implication is that the brand can't just sit there. It has to represent you're moving forward. Status has to pay dividends, and it's better if they pay them on a regular basis. So this is Communications Bank. It's a credit card company. And credit cards, for us, are usually all about freedom. In China, there are about two things. One is making sure that you can buy what you want and have a plan for it, so there's a lot of control in it. But secondly, it's a door opener. It's welcoming you to a new world. It's opening you up and welcoming to privilege. And technology too. Technology, and this is very important for you guys, technology has to be viewed as a weapon. Technology has two purposes in life. One is for the child, and the second is to help dad move forward by giving him a competitive edge on the business battlefield. If you just have productivity all by itself, it will fall flat. If you have productivity that pulls you along, it can work very well. Let's talk about women a little bit later, but technology and women, it's not as powerful. We'll talk about women later. This is GPRS. You can see this is like 20 years ago. Passat is also teaching you the rules of advancement. And notice the end, it is with Napoleon.
萨克，成就明天。
Third theme is a little bit odd, I suppose, because I've just talked about projection, but let's always remember the protection side of things. And this is a Confucian society where conformity still is paramount and individualism is dangerous. You want to stand out, but you want to stand out subtly. So this is about inconspicuous conspicuosity. And I've just made up a new word. But the point is that you want to avoid blatant showing off. So, for example, in the car market, Audi, which is the second level, right, is much more successful and popular and safe than Mercedes or BMW, which is at the first level. Because if you have one of those cars, people instinctively ask or automatically ask, he must be corrupt. How did he get all that money? The same thing for the Mont Blanc pen. This is one of male's favorite status symbol because it is very discreet, but when you put the pen in the pocket, the little star, white star, is an eye magnet. So it is a very subtle sparkle. And so even for diamonds, you want to avoid being the deliberate center of a focus. You want the response to be sort of like, can I help it if they notice me? What, me? It's not my fault. It's the beauty of the diamond. Right? So this is a typical commercial targeted to women, by the way, where we're having, there are two types of diamonds, purchased for couples and purchased by women for themselves. And this is called blame it on the diamond. And you can see here that the woman doesn't know everybody's looking at her. She's just admiring her pretty diamond. Actually, the translation for that is more, it was all provoked by the diamond. You know, it's not just blame it on the diamond. Theme four is a balance of aspiration and accessibility. We've said already that Chinese are very ambitious, but they're also the most optimistic. The middle class is the most optimistic generation on earth right now. They do believe that with the right opportunity, they can pull themselves forward. They do believe that tomorrow will be better than today with the right clever resourcefulness. But on the other hand, pennies, again, are pinched and resources are strapped. So you need to balance this very delicately, on one hand being shiny and clean. There's no cynicism at all. There is no anti-advertising movement. In fact, brands are fully embraced. There's no consumer nihilism. It really is, brands are beautiful. It's Leave It to Beaver in color. It's scrubbed right down to the shine. Look, I can see myself. But on the other hand, you don't want to have dad driving home in a Mercedes because that is beyond what can be achieved. So in every advertisement, and this depends on what the product is and who your market target is, you do want to have this balance of the accessible but not the inaccessible, aspirational always. So you want to balance top floor feel with accessibility, and this is really a matter of execution. But this is just a very everyday product. It's an instant coffee with a little bit of taste of Paris. She's not going to Paris. She's dreaming of a little moment in the Paris rain, which is, I think, very similar to what I'm experiencing in Seattle. I've got five more minutes, by the way. Sorry. Theme 5 is home. This is very important for Microsoft, I think, okay, because the home has a very different role in China as it does in the West. You can summarize this by saying the Chinese never throw dinner parties. Yes, they bring over their family, but you never have a lot of friends just come over casually and sit around the table. Those are done around round tables in restaurants for the most part. The home in China is a refuge. The home in China is this place of self-expression, safety, comfort, respite, sometimes escape. The home is a place where you want to bring the rest of the world's joy into it, but you are not there to demonstrate your status. Nobody will ever pay a premium for a designer bedspread. So make sure that you understand the role that the home plays, not just with respect to the individual, but the family and the nurturing of the entire family. Now this is, and home sales are taking off. I don't want to get into the statistics. They're more than taking off. Everybody owns a home now. But the home is a canvas on which you paint your dreams. Right? So it's not for showing off. It's for, at best, self-expression. Now I don't want to play this one because we don't have the time, but this is a commercial that really has the home as a mother's womb, basically. It's so safe. But I do want to play, oh, I hope I've got it still, yes. TCL, this is a flat screen television, and I'm not saying this is directly relevant to you guys and to entertainment, but what's happening here is you've got a flat screen, and instead of talking about how nice it looks in a design component, you're talking about it as empowerment in your home. Here we're saying this is so thin, nobody is going to tell you where you can put your television set. It can be put inside the home, in the bathroom.
So what do you think?
Very cool. 享受 7.8 厘米 非常之薄 TCL 等离子电视机
So what do you think?
I'm really amazed.
视听空间 我做主
And by the way, for those that are taking notes, this is the outer limit of sexuality in Chinese advertising. We negotiated for a long time. And finally, the child. It all comes back to the child. Because many people ask me, Tom, do you think that this is going to be out of date in 5 years or 7 years or 2 years? And I say, not really. Because the fundamentals of Chinese culture are consistent over time, reinforced over 5,000 years of unbroken civilization. So this basic conflict, okay, will exist in the middle class as long as it is still rising. Now the expression of this conflict is going to change over time, but ultimately the child is the receptacle of Chinese values. And in China, the child is both for investment in the future and as well as a demonstration of the family's success in a projective sense. So the child is an investment, which is why computers have home penetration of over 50% in practically every major eastern seaboard city right now. Are they buying computer for dad's productivity? Absolutely not. They're buying the computer for the child and the education of the child. Dad comes second, right? Investment in the children, you know, for kindergarten, you spend an average of a year's income for a magnet kindergarten school fees. So people will spare no expense. Just one thought is for Microsoft and its software applications and the ancillary products that can surround it, bring it back to the child. Don't just have it be commoditized a bits of data and the paperclip guy that is an annoyance. You want to make sure that it aids the entire education. You want to develop programs around it so that it can't be copied, so that if they don't have the seal of legitimacy, they can't take advantage of a Microsoft world that opens the doors for your children's future. Now that's different than what you guys currently have right now. Huh?
What
kind of safety?
Well, so if you're running not legitimate software.
Oh, well, let's talk about that in just a second. Absolutely. I mean, there are two ways to make something like this non-commoditized. One is to talk about forward advancement, and that can come through the child most powerfully. And the second is, if you don't buy the right version, things can go wrong. All right. So you have to one second, I'm almost done. All right. You have to dramatize the negative without being too dark and gloomy. But the fact of the matter is that even for something like Louis Vuitton, you have to make that logo so that anybody can see whether it's got a false stitch. You have to train people to look for the false stitch, because nobody worth their salt would be caught dead with a fake Louis Vuitton that can afford one. So the child also is for projection. The child gains face. It's for both protection and projection. And so the implication is that the child has to be projection of parents' aspirations. And this is the last commercial I want to pay, because it's sort of like a technology product. It's a printer. And it's not about dad's productivity at work. It's a color printer. But you can see what's happening here is that it is a premium product being presented as an investment vehicle for children. Right? So this is helping educate the child. But at the end, of course, the projective glory of the child shines through like the bat signal. This was
my mom and my 所以每天在的夏天去看鱼。四岁的夏天，喜欢黏着爸爸，就这样，夏天和爸爸一起学会了华尔兹。六岁的夏天，在努力想当海豚的那天下午，变成了海豚。
Big kid. Now, so that's basically the summary page. What I basically suggested is that due to a combination of Confucian ambition and regimentation, as well as an insecurity caused by lack of civil institutions and the protection of individual economic interests, you have a pinched middle class that wants to both project status, which is expensive, and also protect, which is all about savings and deferred consumption. And so we've taken that conflict between project and protect, and we've turned it into a few themes that you can use to think about. This is not a cookbook, by the way. You don't just pick one and put it on your TV commercial. But public display, you want to maximize public display value whenever possible. You want to make sure that status is dynamic, not passive. It is alive. It isn't inert. It helps move you forward. You want to keep, it pays dividends. You want to keep a low profile, but still get people to notice you. And that's monochromatic with a flash of color. You want to balance between aspiration and accessibility, making sure that project a good vision of tomorrow, an idealized vision of tomorrow, but not one that breaks with reality. The home is a place of refuge and escape and nurturing, possibly self-expression, and the role of the child in the home is absolutely parent. It is a paramount. The home is a cocoon. And finally, the child, in general, is both projective and protective. The child is what makes sure that these Chinese values that we've been talking about are not going to be eliminated with the first gust of McDonald's commercials and Pepsi ads. It will remain a Chinese civilization for the next couple thousand years, but it will become modern and international. And that's what I have to say. Thank you. I don't know whether we want to ask questions or...
One or two?
Okay. Anybody want to, one or two questions? Yes, sir.
You mentioned that half the family buy a beautiful child.
Yeah.
How would it play in the Chinese version of Peoria if the guy buying the software would have his name coming up in lights at boot time?
In Peoria? In Peoria?
In the Chinese Peoria.
Oh, Chinese Peoria. I think it's a little over the top, because I don't think that people want to show up in the home, and I don't think they want to show up in the privacy of their office. But on the other hand, you can have initials on briefcases, and that will work well. Yes?
So going back to the question, you said the two things I'm trying to control balancing is the not showing off in the home, and yet there's a lot of high-end fixtures and plumbing and other things in some of the ads that we've seen. Is that just dressing to sell the
Well, first of all, notice there is a difference between the public area of apartment buildings, which are really glitzy. Okay, so there you've got lots of marble, lots of chandeliers, but in the home, Shanghai chic, you know, very streamlined. I've just seen the advertising, de-pimp your car, you know, or unpimp your car. That's very true in China as well, because they're going very beyond that rococo, ostentatious, gaudy. The inside home should be more sleek, and it should be more understated, but still very comfortable and clean and bright. Yes, but in the home, you don't need ostentatious displays.
About women and about the differences between what you've talked about and women. You touched on that real briefly, and I don't have a lot of time.
Yeah, I've got all the time in the world. I just have to go back and take a nap. I'm on jet lag time, but But women, let me quickly define the difference between men and women in China. Okay, men are caught between a need to achieve a very narrow definition of success, which is, you know, money and acquisition of wealth. And historically in China, there's always been a sure path to getting there, and it's about sharpening the mind. Today, it's with capitalistic reform, it's changed from a no pain, no gain to a high risk, high reward credo. So the key thing that men are looking for in this new era is control. All right, they want to make sure that something is tosh or in their hands, their own business, stable, because they know that it's hard to find your way in this new world. So men are looking for a way through the maze. Women, on the other hand, are caught between three very different poles. The first two are social mandates. One is the protective, kind Confucian mother, the warm, gentle, caring angel on one hand, and on the other hand, it's the Confucian and Maoist imperative, but particularly Maoist, of the woman warrior, she who produces for the motherland. And she is, you know, very aggressive, very strong. So a woman has to be, on one hand, iron fist with a velvet glove. A woman wants to move forward, but she never wants to sacrifice her femininity and her charm. And now you've got the tantalizing appeal of Western-style individualism, which is not a social mandate. So to make a long story short, a woman finds it impossible to be a good modern woman because the social mandates are juxtaposed and actually polarized. And then there's this confusing illusion of true individualism. So a woman is always trying to balance the softness and this, you know, toughness at the same time. And that's about balance. So key word for women is balance. Key word for men is control. Yes?
Middle class Chinese seem to pursue glorious stuff, like good cars, mm-hmm. Diamond rings. But at the same time, they also want to keep low profile.
Right.
Is this a contradiction?
Well, yes, it is a contradiction. So that's why Mont Blanc is so successful. So, and that's why Audi is so much more successful than Mercedes. The point is to help resolve that conflict. So it can be a conflict, but you can also resolve that conflict. Great marketing resolves tension. Great brands are what I call paradox brands. They hit two birds with one stone, or as the Chinese say, yi zhu liang de. And that is really the unexpected combination. And that's what Mont Blanc does. Yes?
So,
this is the last one, so this had better be good.
Well, we've had some good success marketing in China, at least from what I've heard.
I'm not like a China expert on Microsoft. But...
Well, yeah, with certification.
Yep.
And, so part of the deal is you go to a certification class and you get your certification, but you've also paid...
You mean, of a user?
Yeah.
Being a user.
Being a user. Yeah. So you're certified that you have, you know, that your office certified.
Right.
And then part of the deal is you get a legitimate, genuine copy of Microsoft software that you paid for as part of your certification.
Right.
So I'm kind of wondering why that works in light of what you've told us.
Well, that works for two reasons. One, it's a reassurance that it's the real thing, okay? But the second
recognizing genuine stuff that's part of the training.
Yeah, and then the second thing, of course, is it's an ancillary product and service that adds value into the software beyond what any other software program, fake or real, could do. And what you're really trying to do is extend that brand into more experiential realm, which goes further out into the non-replicatable world. So that's why it's working. And I think that what you guys need to do is think of many, many more ways to do that certification program, which exists on two levels. One is proof of performance, but then the other is application, which again can help you move forward. So what you need to do in China is just that certification, but times 100 in many different ways.